C-1. You know what that means? Conference minus one day. Conference starts tomorrow. We're going to be broadcasting live tomorrow from right outside the main conference room.
In the hypostyle hallway of the La Jolla Hotel.
Hypostyle means...
giant columns.
I had a... I wish I had gone with that because they are big columns they've got over there.
Like the hypostyle hallway at Karnak in Egypt, only no hieroglyphs on these columns.
Oh, yeah. Yeah. That's an awful lot of columns at Karnak, too, because I don't think they were good at building roofs that could span columns.
They liked frequently the open air thing, although not for most temples in Egypt. Most temples were closed in, except Akhenaten's.
Oh, because he was the sun.
He worshipped a solar deity, and so he had these bizarro temples that were open to the sun, and his solar proclivities were not popular either at home or with foreign ambassadors. We have a letter from a foreign dignitary complaining about how his ambassadors were required to wait in the hot sun.
Oh, he just cook them because he loved Mr. Sun.
The sun, the solar disk.
Mm-hmm. You can hear Jimmy Akin is our guest. Jimmy is senior apologist here at Catholic Answers. And his latest book is The Bible is a Catholic Book, which you can get now pretty much anywhere where you can get a book. So we're kind of doing what we might call a Bible open forum today. Your questions about the Bible, any question you have about the Bible is welcome. 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. You will be with us for an open forum tomorrow in the hypostyle hallway there at the
of La Jolla.
Of La Jolla. Again, 888-318-7884. It's all about the Bible today, and your calls are welcome. I got already a bunch of calls, Jimmy.
Yay.
Shall we?
Oh, sure.
All right.
Unless you have questions you'd like to ask.
I feel like I'm just going to let the listeners go for a while.
Because
I want to be popular on Facebook.
Okay.
I'm working on being popular on Facebook.
That's good.
All right. Let's start with Robert in Atlanta, Georgia, listening on The Quest Catholic Radio, spanning Atlanta. Robert, your question for... hang on there, Robert. Robert, your question for Jimmy.
Yeah, hi. Thank you for taking my call. I'm very pleased to talk to Jimmy. That man is brilliant, I have to tell you.
He is indeed
I
kind.
I listen to him, and he knows everything. He's amazing.
Well, the
okay, so my question is
Dunning-Kruger effect doesn't allow me to say that, but thank you so much.
So my question, when I listen in Mass, and they say, you know, Jesus said, this is my body and this is my blood.
Mm-hmm.
And then later on, when he is pierced on the cross, and Scripture says he bled and water also came out.
Mm-hmm.
Is it a possibility that maybe blood and wine came out and it was actually wine and not water?
Oh, so it would be like white wine in this case.
Well, that's what they serve at Mass is white wine.
They frequently do. That's for various reasons, including it's easier to clean the altar linens afterwards. But there's no prohibition on using red wine. And I believe that red wine has been used historically, and it's my guess that it's what would have been used in the first century, though that's a guess more than anything else. I haven't done the research to confirm that. Is it possible that in addition to blood, it was white wine flowing out? Well, it doesn't involve a contradiction in terms, so it's a logical possibility. And it's not like the phrase square circle or four-sided triangle. So it's logically possible. And anything that's logically possible is something that God can bring about by virtue of his omnipotence. So God could make wine and blood flow out of Christ's side if he wanted to. As illustration of that fact, I would point to the fact that Christ himself transformed water into wine. So God could take whatever bodily substance he wanted and transform it into wine. That's certainly within his ability to do. I personally wouldn't think it's the most likely thing, though. I suspect that you're correct in saying that this passage in Scripture is using what we call phenomenological language. That means the language of appearances. Lots of scholars have taken this passage as saying that the gospel describes this event based on how it appeared. It appeared that what flowed from Christ's side was both water and blood, but that doesn't mean that the water was necessarily water. In fact, one of the very common theories is that it was something other than water, not wine, but a different bodily fluid, something like plasma. We all have in our blood, we have plasma. That's what the liquid part of our blood is. And what normally makes that red is the presence of red blood corpuscles in it. And we see the red light reflecting off the red blood corpuscles, and it makes the plasma look red. But if you separate, like we do this today with centrifuges, if you go to donate plasma, yeah, for example, they'll take a pint of your blood, they'll spin it around in a centrifuge, and that causes the red blood platelets to separate from the plasma. And once they're separated, the plasma does indeed look clear, kind of a little, maybe a little yellowish, but like a clear liquid. And a lot of scholars and medical experts have looked at this passage and said, well, you know what happens sometimes in cases of heart failure is your blood begins to separate in this way. And you can and it can build up, the plasma can build up either in the pleural cavity around your lungs or in a special sac. It's called the pericardial sac. Peri means around, and cardium is heart, so the pericardial sac is a membrane that's around your heart. And the idea is that as a result of all the trauma he suffered, Christ had was experiencing cardiac failure, and that led to his blood starting to clot and coagulate in this way, and that resulted in a separation of the red portion from the other plasma that was clear. And then when the sword punctured his side, or the spear punctured his side, that allowed the two partially separated substances to flow out, and that's why they were perceived as looking like blood and water, which is how they're described. And of course, there's spiritual meaning there, blood suggesting the Eucharist and water suggesting baptism. But it may well have been that this was just the language of appearances, and actually it was partially separated blood that came out, making it look like blood and water.
Okay, Robert.
Very good. Again, I'm very, very impressed with your knowledge. it's a pleasure to listen to you.
Thank you so much, and thank you for calling in.
And don't ask him about football. You'll be less impressed.
You'll be considerably less impressed.
Jimmy's latest book is The Bible is a Catholic Book. This hour we dedicate to questions about the Bible. If you have a question about the Bible, whatever it is, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. I will share this from Facebook. Jimmy, Margaret from the UK, a little note for you.
Uh-huh.
A Daily Defense is proving very useful. Thank you, Jimmy.
Good. That's awesome.
That's another one of Jimmy's books, A Daily Defense, 365 Days Plus One to Becoming a Better Apologist. We'll let Margaret have the last word on that, and we'll be right back after this.
We're here for you. Give us a call today on Catholic Answers Live.
The Aquinas Writing Advantage Program is part of Homeschool Connections' set of online courses for your Catholic homeschool. Homeschool Connections website is homeschoolconnections.com.
Underwriting for Catholic Answers Live is provided by Real Estate for Life. Real Estate for Life connects home buyers and sellers to real estate agents while supporting pro-life organizations. On the web at realestateforlife.org.
Dr. Doctor, featuring doctors Tom McGovern, Chris Stroud, and Andrew Mullally.
The number of people who are on government assistance expanded so much. Personally, I have patients in my office in tears saying, you know, I never thought of myself as somebody on government assistance. I just bought a new car. I can afford a brand new car, but I'm still on Medicaid.
Dr. Doctor, Saturdays at 11 a.m. Eastern on EWTN Radio.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live in the studio today. Tomorrow we'll be over at the conference, broadcasting from the conference the next 2 days. If you're coming to the conference, look forward to meeting you. Please say hello. We'd love to say hello to you. Some folks visiting us in studio today. Hello, conference goers. Not you, Nick. Well, thank you for waving, Nick.
Nick's a conference goer.
I see Nick.
He's going to be there.
Yeah, he will be there.
He's going to be running the board.
Yes. All right. I'll wave to you, Nick. Oh, there you go. The number 888-318-7884. This hour, it's all Bible, all the time. If you've got a question about the Bible, you are welcome to ask. Jimmy Akin, senior apologist here at Catholic Answers. Before I go back to the calls, if you haven't signed up for Jimmy's free video course, you can delve deeper into God's holy word. Video one deals with Sola Scriptura. So just visit Catholic.com right now and click on the free video course title. You got to go down near the bottom of the page, all right? So it's free. You can enroll today and start Jimmy's course on the Bible. Up next, Edward in Los Angeles, California, watching on YouTube Live. Edward, your question for Jimmy.
Thank you. Jimmy, in the Old Testament, when they refer to the angel of the Lord, what is the church's teaching on the identity of the angel of the Lord? Is it Jesus? I've seen that in a study Bible footnote, particularly the Orthodox study Bible and the footnotes to the Septuagint.
Mm-hmm. The church doesn't have a teaching on what the angel of the Lord is. the term could be understood various ways. The term angel in Hebrew and in Greek and in Latin just means messenger. And so the depiction of God as a heavenly king was sufficiently well established that they would use, the ancient Israelites would use language describing kings and their courts to describe how God and his heavenly retinue worked in heaven. So you would have, just like a king would have messengers that he would send to announce his will, well, you have messengers of the Lord or angels of the Lord. Also, a king's court would typically have a prosecutor or an adversary whose job it would be to accuse people of crimes in cases that the king would then judge. And the Hebrew word for that job, an accuser, Satan. And that's what we see Satan doing in the book of Job. He's functioning as the heavenly prosecutor. In that case, like a lot of prosecutors, he's prosecuting someone, namely Job, unjustly.
Mm-hmm.
And you similarly have references like in the book of Joshua, there's an appearance by the captain of the Lord's host, a host being an army, and so the captain of the Lord's army. And so you have this application of terms from a king's court here on earth to the heavenly court of God. And one meaning, therefore, for the term the angel of the Lord would just be he's just one of these messengers. He's nobody special. He's just an individual messenger. But the use of the definite article in Hebrew, it's ha. The definite article can, it doesn't have to, but it can mean that this is like the one special angel. Like this is the chief messenger of the Lord. And so he could be someone special. He could be the Lord's chief messenger. Also, there's something very odd that happens in some of these passages with the angel of the Lord, where even though it talks about the angel of the Lord being present and doing something, it then seems as if the angel sort of is the Lord. Because he'll speak in the Lord's voice. And so, for example, you see this in the binding of Isaac in that story. Even though the angel is there, the angel's talking like he himself is God. And so there have been people, not just Christians, but some Jewish scholars and mystics have also looked at these passages and said it seems like the angel of the Lord is kind of God himself. In some sense. And that led early church fathers to talk about the angel of the Lord as potentially being the pre-incarnate Christ. Same thing for the commander of the Lord's army. So you will find church fathers speculating that the angel of the Lord is the pre-incarnate Christ sent on a mission and serving in the capacity of an angel, meaning this is his job. I believe it was Augustine
who said that angel is their job title, not what they are in essence.
Right.
Yeah. What they are in essence is a spirit, but they're functioning as a messenger. So mm-hmm. we call them messengers. And so in this case, Jesus, well, he's the Word of God. He's certainly a message and a messenger.
Mm-hmm.
So you could conceive of Jesus in that way as an angel, but he's not a finite created messenger. He's an infinite uncreated messenger. And so you will find, as I said, some figures in the history of the church, going all the way back to the church fathers, speculating that the angel of the Lord is the pre-incarnate Christ, but the church doesn't have that as a teaching.
Edward, thank you very, very much for the call. Lots of calls. People have a desire to talk about the Bible, I guess, today, so we are going to keep going with those calls.
Because we asked him to.
Well, sometimes I have to say, Jimmy, not always when you're here. As a matter of fact, mostly when you're not.
Uh-huh. I'm not here.
When you're not here. No, mostly, no. This only happens usually when you're not here.
Uh-huh.
That we don't get that many calls. That'll happen sometimes.
Okay.
So it's not just because we asked them.
Okay.
It's because they want to ask
you. Maybe.
Right.
We'll see.
And by the way,
yeah,
Jimmy is not perfect.
No, he's far from it.
He's not an android. I just want to get some of the ideas that people have about you.
Okay.
Out of the way. So, uh-huh. Actual human being.
Yep.
So
that's my story. I'm sticking to it.
Okay, good. You do that. Brian in San Antonio, listening on Guadalupe Radio. You are next. Your question on the Bible for Jimmy Akin. Hi, Brian.
Hi. Good afternoon. I was just wondering, in the gospel, forgive me, I'm driving, so I don't have it in front of me, but when Jesus is teaching and Mary and his brothers or cousins are outside, and the apostles say, aren't they going to come in? And I was just wondering what your thoughts on it. It kind of comes off as a little dismissive, those who do the will of my father or my mother and brothers. Obviously, it's his mom, so I wouldn't think that he would be so dismissive, but I'm just wondering what your take is on how it kind of comes across that way.
Okay. I think that this is a situation that's a lot like the Japanese movie Rashomon. I don't know if you're familiar with that, but Rashomon is a classic black and white Japanese movie about the difference of perspective that people can have. In Rashomon, you have an event occurs in the woods, and it's seen by several different people. And even though they saw the same event, they interpret it quite differently. And there's something similar to that happening when we read this account in the Gospels. If you read Mark's account, Jesus sounds more dismissive than if you read Luke's account. And so I think that this is an event that can be viewed from more than one way. Fundamentally, I don't think Jesus was, I think we can all agree, at least all Orthodox Christians who believe that Jesus is the sinless Son of God, we can all agree that Jesus was not being fundamentally disrespectful of family. God himself instituted the family. He recognizes the bonds and obligations we have towards fellow family members. And in particular, Jesus would have recognized the obligation he had towards his mother, because one of the Ten Commandments is honor your father and mother, or translated another way from Hebrew, glorify your father and mother. And so Jesus, however it may come across in a particular passage, and Mark is noted for his unpolished style in Greek. He has several stylistic elements in Greek that when the other evangelists like Matthew and Luke are quoting from him, they smooth out Mark's style to make it better Greek. And they similarly clarify things that could have been more ambiguous in Mark, and then they'll in their presentation of them, they'll make it clearer what Mark was trying to say. And this could be an example of that. Mark could have written his initial description, and it caused some people to think Jesus was being more disrespectful than he was, and consequently Luke corrects that and clarifies, here's what actually happened. He wasn't being disrespectful. The basic point that Jesus is making is not to run his own family down. The basic point that he's making is what everybody needs to do is obey the will of God. And if you are obeying the will of God, that makes you a member of the same spiritual family. And so that's his fundamental point. And he uses his own family to help make that illustration. He's not saying they're not doing the will of God, but he's stressing what is important is doing the will of God. And that's what's ultimately important. As important as family may be on the natural level, what's even more important is doing the will of God. And so that's his fundamental point. And we're not really warranted to go beyond that and say, therefore, he's running down his own family. This is similar to other situations where you have to look at what's Jesus's main point. There's even a parallel in the scriptures where in one of the gospels, Jesus is presented as saying, unless you hate your father and your mother, you can't be my disciple. And that's a vivid way of saying you have to prefer God and Jesus over your mother and father. Your fundamental loyalty has to be to God, not to family members. But he's using this kind of dramatic way mm-hmm. of making the point. But he doesn't mean you literally have to hate your father and mother. And that's clarified in another one of the Gospels where it said that if anyone prefers his father or mother to me, he can't be my disciple. But he, like a lot of figures in ancient Israel, had a colorful way of speaking, but you really have to look at what's the underlying message rather than the surface level message.
Brian, thank you. I hope that was helpful. I am very happy I can go back to loving my father and mother. Up next is Rob.
You have to get to put an end to that vendetta then.
Yeah. Right, that's over.
Okay, good.
Right. I'll have to see how they feel about me now. But Robbie in Kentucky, you're next. Robbie's listening on WCLR. Robbie, your Bible question for Jimmy Akin.
All right. Good afternoon, guys. Thanks for everything you all do, spreading the truth.
Thank you.
A dear friend of ours, in college, Catholic college no less, has a love interest. They're Mormon, and she's found herself investigating Mormonism, LDS. And I've been posed with the question of continuing revelation. Our catechism states that general revelation ended with the death of the last apostles, and whereas LDS believe in continuing revelation. And what I'm looking for is a biblical explanation of our church teaching.
Okay. Well, the New Testament doesn't indicate that there's going to be a cessation of revelation altogether. and so the church acknowledges in the catechism that private revelation can end and has ended. That private revelation can go on, but it indicates also that public revelation has ended. That means revelation that's binding on all of us as a matter of faith. Private revelation is not binding on everybody as a matter of faith, but public revelation is. And that fact is a fact of tradition. It's not something that's stated in the New Testament. However, there are a number of things that are stated that can be appealed to in this regard. One of them is Jude 3's statement that the faith has been delivered to the saints once for all. And that means that the substance of the Christian faith, maybe not every detail, but the substance of the Christian faith had already been revealed by Jesus Christ, and there weren't to be any new fundamental planks of the Christian faith that would be added subsequently. It also means there's not going to be a fall of the church into apostasy and a later re-revelation of the faith, because the faith has been delivered once for all time. And so it's not going to be lost and then re-announced by Joseph Smith 1,800 years later. In addition, we are told in both the Old and the New Testament that new revelations need to be consistent with what God has already revealed. And unfortunately, you apply that standard to the revelations of Joseph Smith, and they're not. And this is even admitted by Mormons themselves. They'll say the church fell into an apostasy and abandoned the true faith. And so they admit that the faith that's been handed down
from the Catholic Church from the beginning is inconsistent with their revelations. The Christians have always understood that there is one God, he's uncreated, and he's fundamentally different than human beings in kind. Mormons, by contrast, believe that all intelligences are eternal, including ours, that we've always existed, and that we grow and develop through a series of processes over the course of the eons, and that God is just a member of our species and he's another finite being like us. That's inconsistent with previous revelation, and it's inconsistent with the fact Jesus said the gates of hell would never prevail against his church. His church cannot fall into an apostasy like Mormons have proposed. So those are some brief talking points on this. We've got a lot more resources at Catholic.com on Mormonism.
Thanks, Robbie. Lots of folks on the line. We're talking Bible. If you've got a Bible question, Jimmy Akin is here to give you an answer.
Everybody's favorite Catholic outer space delivery pilots return for their greatest adventure yet in the brand new graphic novel Weapons of War. Fresh from saving the solar system in The Truth Is Out There and saving the timeline of salvation history in The Big Picture, Brendan and Irk land in a magnificent domed city on Mars for what is supposed to be a simple shuttle job. But soon they find themselves caught up in a sinister assault on faith and freedom. Will Mars be lost to the enemy? Brendan and Irk's only hope for the flight is in the power of God's sacramental gifts. A totally new kind of Catholic resource for apologetics and evangelization, The Truth Is Out There series combines the visual excitement and quirky humor of graphic novels with solid popular philosophy and theology. The result is a series in which everyone from teens to adults can find accessible answers to questions about God, the soul, true happiness, and much more. Order your copy of Weapons of War today by calling 844-239-4952, by visiting shop.catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
If you're a Catholic who sometimes gets intimidated by the Bible, Jimmy Akin's The Bible is a Catholic Book will help you better understand and take pride in this gift that God gave the world through the Church. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Catholics are the original Bible Christians. Order your copy of The Bible is a Catholic Book today by calling 844-239-4952, by visiting shop.catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Do you believe you don't measure up?
Tell us why on tomorrow's Take Two with Jerry and Debbie at noon Eastern.
Now let's return to more of Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. Jimmy Akin is our guest. His newest book is The Bible is a Catholic Book. It's from Catholic Answers Press. You can get it at shop.catholic.com. And one thing I should continue to mention is it is available in bulk. So if you're thinking about, hey, maybe this Advent, this is something I could give away to the people in my parish, you know, if the pastor says it's all right, or maybe the parish wants to. Sometimes parishes do that. They have a book that they give away to people who come at Christmas time, that kind of thing, or at any time, maybe for the Feast of Christ the King or for the end of ordinary time. It's up to you, but you can get them in bulk. A box of 20 is just
$3. To be nice.
Yeah, you could do that.
Just to be nice.
That's right. There's always that option as well. No, I need a Catholic feast to attach all charity
no,
to.
No, you don't.
No, really?
No.
Okay, all right.
But it is like you buy a case of 20, you get them for $3 each, which is an awesome price. Today, yeah. Our marketing director, Donna Barrick, had a report where she mentioned apparently lots of people are buying the cases.
Oh, great.
Lots of people are doing that.
Wonderful, because it is one of those books that you want to get out into people's hands. In part, I would say because open up the Bible in a way that is very direct and very helpful, so that you're not so scared of the Bible if you have that feeling, or just overwhelmed by the size and the complexity and the ancientness of the Bible. But also, It lets you know where the Bible comes from. And I do think people, this is information that is very, very helpful when you are deciding, especially when the choice is being made about whether one will be a disciple of Christ, whether one will accept his invitation or not. So you can go to shop.catholic.com. You can get the book for yourself, or you can get a box of 20 for $3 each. 888-318-7884, the number here. Our next Bible question comes from an anonymous caller. Anonymous, do we have you there with us?
Hello.
Hello.
My question is, why does the church only have a three-year cycle? Because they're leaving out parts of the Bible, and therefore people that need to know the truth about subjects, I'm going to be specific on this one, on homosexuality. And if you look in the catechism, in 2357, they call homosexuality a grave depravity and that it's intrinsically disordered. Most people are not walking around with the catechism. But the problem is with the church only doing the three-year cycle, they never read Romans 1, 26 to 28 and 1 Corinthians 6, 9 to 12 and Leviticus 18, 22 to 24. And all in those parts of the Bible, it clearly states that homosexuality is a sin and it's immoral. And if people heard this in church, they would have a different stance on this instead of this kumbaya feeling that, well, they can't help it and they're born that way and it's okay. And we're not helping people to reach eternal salvation if we don't speak the truth in love.
Is there a question for me, Anonymous?
So the question is, why are we not reading these verses in Scripture instead of just always doing this three-year cycle? It's like having a nice time.
Okay. I think I got the sense of the question. Now, the church used to have a one-year cycle prior to the Second Vatican Council. And at the Second Vatican Council, it was decided that the church wanted to make a broader array of biblical passages read in church so that people would have an even greater exposure. There was not a decision, though, to read the entire Bible. That's, you know, something one could have different opinions about. One might decide that after thinking about it, well, it would be good if the church did read the entire Bible, but it would probably be something like a 10-year cycle, and there would be a question of, you know, how much would people retain after 10 years, because the Bible is large enough that that it would take a really lengthy amount of time for people to hear the whole thing. And so a decision was made that the church would have a three-year cycle for Sundays and holy days, and that a two-year cycle would be used for weekdays and Saturdays. And that meant, because it's cycles of only that length, it meant that you couldn't possibly get through the entire Bible in that amount of time. And so decisions had to be made on which passages would be included and which passages weren't. These decisions were basically made by people at what's now called the Congregation for Divine Worship and the Discipline of the Sacraments. And they were approved by the Pope, Paul VI at the time, but he didn't personally decide every passage. He basically approved what they presented to him with maybe some input from himself. And so if you're asking why were these verses not included, well, I don't know. I would be actually surprised that the relevant passage of Romans 1 wouldn't be read, but it could well be. But that's the basic reason. If you're asking why, it's because the people who were put in charge of drafting the cycles of readings chose not to include various passages. That's the answer for these as well as any others that aren't included. And if you're wondering, did the fact they deal with a sensitive issue like homosexuality have a role in why they're not there? Well, I don't know. Maybe it did, maybe it didn't. It would be a matter of speculation, and I don't have information about these individuals in particular that would allow me to answer that. But if you you know, feel that the church is not reading something that would be of special value to people to hear, whether it's on this or any other topic, you can certainly write the Congregation for the Doctrine of the Faith and suggest that in a future revision this be taken into account.
Thank you very, very much, Anonymous, for that call. Jimmy Akin, our guest, his brand new book is The Bible is a Catholic Book. This hour we are devoting to the Bible. If you have a question about the Bible, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. I want to take just a moment to invite you to listen to our latest episode of Focus. It's up right now at CatholicAnswersFocus.com. Carlo Broussard was kind enough to come in and talk with us about an issue that's getting a lot of attention right now, the Catechism of the Catholic Church. In its paragraph on homosexual inclinations, uses the term objectively disordered, and there has been a call to change that wording. We talked with Carlo about whether that was a good idea to change that wording, and we'd love it if you'd get Focus and maybe even sign up for the Radio Club while you're there and get Focus in your inbox each week. Myra in Huntsville, Alabama, listening to EWTN on Channel 130, Sirius Satellite Radio. You are next. Your question for Jimmy Akin about the Bible.
Yes, thank you so much for taking my call. So my question has to do, it's a question for just a suggestion on a book or books out there that would provide a historical context for the time in which Jesus lived and up to where the New Testament was written. So, like Jimmy was saying earlier, and to piggyback on his comment, he was mentioning something about, oh, the language they used at that time was very colorful. And I'm like, oh, aha, that makes that's the kind of thing I would love to know. I don't know that. And so what books would you suggest?
Well, so are you interested in Jesus's age specifically, or also in ancient Israel before the time of Jesus, or both?
Oh, both.
Okay. If you want a historical survey, now these books are, some of them are coming from a Protestant perspective, but that's not a reason of itself not to read them. It just means you need to be aware that that's the perspective they're coming from. There's a book about Old Testament history by, I believe, Walter Kaiser. He's a Protestant scholar, called A Kingdom of Priests. That's a history of Old Testament Israel. There's also a book by the Protestant scholar F.F. Bruce called New Testament History that deals with the New Testament. And just so you're aware, these are individual scholars' approaches. Now, they're good, reliable, in broad strokes, scholars. I'm not going to agree with everything they have to say about everything. But, you know, that's true of any scholar. Also, if you want to learn more specifically about the culture of the time, there's an excellent book by the Dominican archaeologist and priest Roland DeVoe called Ancient Israel, Its Life and Institutions. It is really good. It's one of my favorite all-time books. It goes through the history of how their culture developed from the period before they were settled in the land, when they were still semi-nomadic, and progresses on, and it talks about the social institutions and the customs that existed at the time in their culture and in surrounding cultures. Excellent book. I really like Ancient Israel, Its Life and Institutions. Also, there's it's called a commentary, but you might be interested in checking out the Bible Background Commentary. It is it was written by an evangelical author, but what it does is it's structured like a Bible commentary, so it's organized by Bible verse. But if you're wondering, is there something in the culture that would help explain a particular verse, this is a good resource. It's a popular level resource. You don't have to be a scholar to read it. It's a popular level resource. You look up that verse and see, is there some relevant cultural background to this verse? And so that's the Bible Background Commentary by InterVarsity Press.
Myra, I'll just let you know, that was a lot that Jimmy just gave. Nick takes notes and then puts that with the show on our website.
In what we call the show notes.
The show. It's cleverly named the show notes. So Myra or anyone else who would like to get those resources, they'll be in the show notes as soon as Nick posts the show, usually just a few minutes after the program. So you can go to Catholic.com to the radio department, find the show you're looking for, and the show notes will be there, and you can get what you're looking for. Myra, thank you very, very much for that call. We have to take a quick break. We'll be right back with more. Basically a Bible open forum with Jimmy Akin right after this.
Bringing you the truth. Catholic Answers Live.
Do you love sharing the gospel and want to learn to be more effective? Join the St. Paul Street Evangelization Online School of Evangelization. You will learn to build bridges of trust and make disciples by befriending strangers, proclaiming the gospel, inviting people to the church, and praying with others. We'll ask for a pledge of financial support, but if you are unable to give, we'll give you a membership at no cost. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
The EWTN home video highlight for September is St. Bridget of Sweden, the movie. She was a wife, mother, and a mystic whose beautiful revelations touched the lives of many throughout the centuries. Order your DVD at EWTNRC.com 24 hours a day, 7 days a week, or call 1-800-854-6316.
This month, Catholic Answers wants you to get into the Bible like never before. A great way to get started is to download our new ebook, The Catholic Answers Guide to Navigating the Bible. Visit shop.catholic.com today and download your free ebook, The Catholic Answers Guide to Navigating the Bible. Jimmy Akin's book is out on the Bible. The Bible is a Catholic book, and you can get that at shop.catholic.com as well. All Bible questions this hour for Jimmy, and up next is Sam in Baltimore, Maryland. Sam, your question for Jimmy Akin.
Hi, am I on?
You're on the air. What's your question?
So my question is there precedence to baptism and communion in the Old Testament? Because when the disciples heard Jesus say, this is my body and blood, I'm not sure how weird it sounded to them, but that's my question.
It would have sounded weird. This is not something that that would have come across in an unstartling manner to them, and you can even see that. How it came across in that time and culture, if you look in John chapter 6. Because in John chapter 6, even though he's not yet at the point of instituting the Eucharist, he does start talking about it. He says, unless you eat my flesh and drink my blood, you have no life in you. And that's met with immediate questioning and opposition by people who overheard it, including some of his own disciples. And some of them couldn't accept it and stopped traveling with Jesus at that point, even though they'd been traveling with him up to that point. But then Jesus turns to the core disciples, including Peter, and says, do you want to go too? And Peter says, well, Lord, you have the words of eternal life. Where are we going to go? So Peter acknowledges that even though this is a hard saying, to use one of the expressions from John 6, this is a hard saying, who can hear it, who can accept it? Peter acknowledged this is a hard saying, but nevertheless was willing to trust Jesus on it, and the other disciples did so as well. So this would have come across on the night of the Last Supper as a very difficult saying at the time, but they'd committed themselves to Jesus, and they knew that he was teaching the truth, and so even though it was difficult, they accepted it. In terms of precedence in the Old Testament for sacraments like the Eucharist and baptism, we do have things that prefigure them. In the Old Testament, one of the things that prefigures the Eucharist was the manna, the miraculous bread that came down from heaven that the Israelites ate, and the disciples might have thought of that. Certainly, later in Christian history, that became a very prominent symbol in connection with the Eucharist. Another thing that they would have thought of even at the time was the sacrifice that Moses used on Mount Zion to institute God's covenant with his people, because Jeremiah the prophet had later predicted that God would make a new covenant with his people. And then in instituting the Eucharist, Jesus said, "This is the new covenant in my blood." And so they would have thought back to Jeremiah's prophecy of the new covenant and to Moses using the blood of a sacrifice to institute God's covenant at Sinai. So they would have thought of both of those immediately because Jesus called attention to them. In terms of baptism, there were a variety of different ceremonial washings that were prescribed in Old Testament ritual and that were part of the daily life of Israelites at the time. There was also John the Baptist's baptism, which even more closely resembled Christian baptism. There's also a prophecy in Ezekiel about how God will change the Israelites' hearts and sprinkle clean water on them and put his spirit inside them in the future. And it's widely thought that that prophecy is what Jesus is referring to in his conversation with Nicodemus in John chapter 3, where Jesus says, unless you're born of water and spirit, you cannot enter the kingdom. And Nicodemus is wondering, how can you be born again? And Jesus says, you're a teacher of Israel and you don't know this, suggesting that the baptism he's talking about is prefigured in Old Testament prophecy. So a teacher of Israel like Nicodemus should know about it. And the logical prophecy in that case is the one from Ezekiel. So those are precedents to the New Testament sacraments in the Old Testament, but how much of that the disciples would have been aware of at the time Jesus instituted the Eucharist is not as clear, except for Jeremiah's new covenant and Moses's use of the blood of the sacrifice in establishing the covenant at Sinai.
Sam, we'll leave it there because there are lots of callers. I hope that that was helpful to you. We're talking the Bible with Jimmy Akin, and Scott in Columbia, South Carolina is next. Scott, your question for Jimmy.
I would like to know if in Catholicism there is a highest angel. It's my understanding that in Jewish
thought,
there is a highest angel, but it goes by a different name, and it's got some eight wings or, you know, all these multiple eyes, and it sounds rather evil to me. And I just wondered if I've been praying for who is my guardian angel, and I've been praying for God to tell me, and so can you elaborate on that?
Sure. So in terms of a highest ranking angel, we don't know for a fact that there is one. It's kind of logical to assume there might be, since angels seem to have a hierarchical structure to their society just like humans do, and typically there's a highest member of any hierarchy. Having said that, it's not impossible that God could have several angels who are direct reports to him. You know,
direct reports like the org, on the org chart.
Exactly.
Okay,
yeah.
Gotcha.
So that's not impossible. The church doesn't have a teaching here. If there is a highest angel, and that's not an unreasonable one, it might be an angel that we know nothing about. We may only know the angels that God has tasked to deal with us, but he's got a whole cosmos to deal with, and maybe multiple cosmoses he's dealing with. So we may know the local reps, but not necessarily the highest guys at the home office.
Is it cosmice? Is
that cosmoses?
Oh, okay. All right. I thought it might be cosmos.
Actually, in the Bible, there are in the Catholic Bible, there are only three angels who are named: Michael, Gabriel, and Raphael. And of those, Michael seems to be the highest ranking. We can show that both from the Old Testament and the New Testament. In the Old Testament, there's a moment in the book of Daniel where Daniel the prophet has been praying, and Gabriel shows up with a message for him. And he says, Gabriel says to Daniel, "I would have been here sooner
But the prince of Persia, meaning the angelic being in charge of Persia, who is, as we'll see in a moment, is on the side of bad, he says, the prince of Persia opposed me. And so Michael, the prince who has charge of your people, meaning he's kind of the guardian angel of Israel,
yeah,
he came and helped me. Mm-hmm. And he's kind of got the prince of Persia in a headlock right now. So I'm here to deliver the message. And then I'm going to go back and Michael and I are going to beat up on the prince of Persia. And that's going to take him out of the way. So Michael seems to be higher ranking than Gabriel in that passage. Also, in the New Testament uses the term archangel. In Greek, it's archangelos for Michael. And that's anytime you have an arche attached to something, it suggests it's high ranking. So the archieros, the high priest, is the high ranking priest. So Michael, as an archangelos, would be a high ranking angel. So that suggests that Michael is at least among the higher ranking angels, maybe the highest. But that's a matter of speculation. Other details about how the angelic hierarchy works. I mean, we see passages that talk about different classes of angels, like seraphim and cherubim and so forth. And some theologians have tried to put those in a hierarchy where, like, okay, the seraphim are higher than the cherubim, maybe, or maybe it's vice versa. But all that's speculative and we don't really know. That's a matter of theological opinion rather than church teaching. In terms of asking God to reveal the name of your angel to you privately, it's possible for God to do that. It's not necessary for God to do that. Your angel is assigned to you and he's committed to doing his job. So he cares about you and loves you and wants to protect you just like he would anybody else, whether you know his name or not. And from a Catholic perspective, you can certainly ask your guardian angel to help you with various things. But the church generally discourages people from trying to learn the name of their guardian angel by private revelation, although it is possible for that to happen if God chooses.
Thank you very, very much. I'm going to try to get to another one, so I will just leave it there and hope that that is helpful to you, Scott. Up next is Marsha in Oklahoma City, Oklahoma. Marsha, you're a question for Jimmy.
Yes. It's great to talk to you, Jimmy. I've been listening to some of the scriptures here recently, and I know that there's layers and layers of translations over the centuries. When Jesus says to the disciples, if they do not take up their own cross, did he literally say their own cross as a prefigurement to his own, or did he use some other term and that's just been substituted in?
Got it. Okay. Marsha?
Well, we sometimes hear that there have been layers of translations over the centuries. That's not really true these days. These days, a typical translation is going to be based directly of the New Testament, is going to be based directly on the Greek. And if it's a translation of the Old Testament, it's going to be based directly on the Hebrew, Aramaic, or Greek. So it's not like the telephone game where you have progressive terms that could intervening that could distort the wording. Jesus probably was speaking to his disciples in Aramaic, but then that got translated in the first century, in fact, in just a few decades, into the Greek that we find in the Gospels. So I would say it's morally certain that the original form of this statement used the standard word for cross that's used elsewhere in the Gospels, stauros. And so I would say that's a first generation translation of the original Aramaic utterance of there. In terms of what it means, well, it certainly does prefigure Jesus' own crucifixion. He knew he was going to die on a cross, and so he told the disciples about that in various ways repeatedly, and the fact that he said, you need to take up your cross or stauros daily would prefigure his own crucifixion. They wouldn't, like many things he said, they wouldn't fully understand it at the time, but after his crucifixion, it would be like, oh, that's what he meant.
Yes.
I have to be willing to follow him even unto death, and I have to be willing to do that at any time, daily, as well as dealing with all the other challenges of daily life as a Christian.
Thank you so much for that question, Marcia. Appreciate it. I hope it was helpful to you. Jimmy Akin has been our guest, and the book is The Bible is a Catholic Book. It's available now. Probably the easiest way to get it is over at shop.catholic.com.
Oh, I wanted to mention something. Earlier in the show, I mentioned a book, A Kingdom of Priests. It's actually by Eugene Merrill.
Okay, Eugene Merrill, A Kingdom of Priests, and that will be on the show notes. Jimmy, thank you very much. Looking forward to seeing you tomorrow at the Hypostyle Hall.
Likewise, Cy Kellett.
All right, coming up next, we're going to talk about the family in the modern world. Is there a more important topic? If there is, it's a rarity. That's next right here on Catholic Answers Live. Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Thanks so much for being with us. I think you will probably agree with me when I say this. If you do not, you are welcome to call. If you do, you're welcome to call as well. The family in the modern world is in a time of distress, and the distress that the family is experiencing has consequences in every single institution of our society. A healthy family means the groundwork has been laid for healthy institutions, including the church. An unhealthy family, a family in distress, means that all the institutions of the society in time feel that distress and suffer the consequences of it. We're talking about the family in the modern world today. 888-318-7884 is our number. If you would like to call and enter that conversation, we would love to have you. 888-318-7884. I must say, here at Catholic Answers Live, we give the Catholic view on these things, and the Catholic Church has very well-established, well-developed, and we think very reasonable views about the family. If you do not share those views, and perhaps you would like to engage in a conversation about the Catholic view of the family, you're welcome to call 888-318-7884. And if you are like myself and our guests today and are concerned about the family and want to engage in a conversation about how to build up the family or maybe rebuild up the family in the context of the modern world, you're welcome to call as well. 888-318-7884. The family in the modern world, our topic, and we have the perfect guest for that. Peter Wolfgang is president of Family Institute of Connecticut, a Harvard-based advocacy organization whose mission is to encourage and strengthen the family as the foundation of society. Peter Wolfgang, thank you for being with us.
Cy, thank you so much for having me.
And you're coming to the conference.
Oh, yes. Looking forward to it.
That's why we get you live in studio with us today. Okay, so in what way can I think of the family as the foundation of society? That's quite a claim. As a matter of fact, many people would maybe dispute that today. We're very individualistic. So how can you make the claim that family is the foundation of society?
Well, I guess I would start where the human person starts, right?
Okay.
We all begin somewhere. None of us just suddenly appear. It takes a mother and a father to make a child. All of us are born into a family. And of course, in the present day, and we can back up and talk more about why this is and what we can do about it. In the present day, we're not always born into a family that is as it should be. It's the will of God. You talked about what we discuss here is informed by our Catholic faith. And the church knows that the family begins with the mother and the father, with marriage as between a man and a woman. In that marriage exists for the procreation and educating of the children. And so when we say that society begins with the family, it's because the human person begins with the family. And apart from a mother and a father, that's really where we learn about love. It's where we learn about God. It's where we learn about the faith. That's really our first church, our domestic church. And the family is absolutely essential. As St. John Paul II said, you know, the future of the world depends on the family. And another thing he said that haunts me, which is why I do this work, Cy.
Okay.
John Paul II once said, families will be the first victims of the societal trends that they have done little more than note with indifference. And that's something that has always haunted me.
Right, right. Yeah. Again, 888-318-7884 is the number. We're talking about the family in the modern context. I wonder, though, listening to you, are you trying to start a fight? Because you keep saying mother and father.
Yeah.
And it has been well established in our era that mother and father are not necessary. You could have two fathers, two mothers. I suppose you could have other arrangements as well. We've seen very many Hollywood actresses, for example, go it alone. So are you trying to start a fight by using these really triggering words, mother and father?
So I would not dispute that there is a fight, but only that I started it.
Okay, fair enough. There's
no question that there's a fight over these things. And those of us who defend the traditional definition of marriage of the family, we're simply engaging the fight that was brought to us. We're the ones defending what marriage has always been. But there are others in our society that had a very deliberate and unfortunately quite successful so far agenda to redefine the family, to say that a mother and a father are not necessary, And our organization, the Family Institute of Connecticut, well, look, let's back up. I want to say something about the Catholic thing, and then I want to say something about the non-Catholic thing as it relates to the family.
Okay.
For myself, I'm a Catholic. Like, the Catholic faith informs everything that I do. And so when I look at the state of the family in the modern world, I start first and foremost with the fact that it is the Catholic Church, right up to the present time, that is the only Christian body that has stayed true to the original teaching held by all Christians, Catholic and non-Catholic, that contraception is immoral. That was something that we all agreed on, even though there were other, you know, there was, of course, the split with the East in 1054. There was the Reformation in the 16th century. And so there's a lot of things that divide us from our separated brethren.
Right, but we were always together on this.
On contraception until the year 1930.
Yeah.
And it's only in the 20th century where things get crazy. And this is where the beauty of the Catholic Church, I think, really shines. Because it was in 1930, excuse me, that the Anglican Church, at its annual, or I think once every 10 years, Lambeth Conference, for the first time, broke away from the traditional Christian teaching and said contraception was permissible. Permissible at that time between married people, but of course it wasn't going to stop there. It was going to go beyond that, and of course it did. And just to give you a sense of what our society was like in 1930, the Washington Post had an editorial that was heavily critical of the Anglican Church for breaking from the traditional Christian teaching on contraception, and said, how can you do this? You know, this is deeply immoral. It's a great harm to family life. Think about from 1930 to 2019, mm-hmm. how far we've traveled, that there was once a time when the Washington Post corrected the Anglican Church on that. But this is where, excuse me, the witness of the Catholic Church is so important, because you had that breakdown in contraception. Eventually, pretty much everyone else, except for the Catholic Church, gave in on contraception. And from there, there was a cascading effect. So that by the 1960s, you have the Age of Aquarius, you have free love, you have everything that Saint Pope Paul VI warned about in Humanae Vitae in 1968. The man was a prophet. He, you know, by the late 1960s, there was this expectation that the Catholic Church was going to give in like everyone else had. And he stood strong in Humanae Vitae. This was the Holy Spirit through the Petrine office guarding the church and saying, no, this is the teaching of the church. Contraception is wrong. It's a violation of the marital covenant. And he went on in a prophetic way to lay out a bunch of things that would happen to society if this became prevalent. And you can jump from that to the hashtag MeToo era. And there's not, you know, a lot of the actresses that are going around talking about Me Too aren't necessarily talking about Pope Paul VI. They may not be big fans of the Catholic Church, but if the world had listened to Paul VI in the Catholic Church,
right,
we wouldn't be in this situation.
Yes.
So by the 1960s here in the United States, and of course, Pope Emeritus Benedict XVI wrote about this very recently in a sort of post-papal encyclical,
right,
about how the sexual revolution affected even the church, the priesthood. I mean, this crisis just engulfs everything, Cy.
Right.
And so by the 1960s, you know, we had that sexual revolution here in the United States. And this is the part that takes us, in a good way, beyond the confines of just the Catholic Church. A lot of evangelical Protestants also understood, because they held to a lot of biblical morality, not all of it, unfortunately, on contraception. But they were with us on just about everything, whereas a lot of the rest of society was falling apart. There was this sort of strange, unexpected alliance of evangelical Protestants and the papacy to maintain biblical morality in post-1960s America.
Right.
And a great manifestation of that was Dr. James Dobson, who was this Church of the Nazarene minister, child psychologist, founded Focus on the Family, which is a Protestant ministry headquartered in Colorado. He founded that in 1976. By the late 1980s, Focus on the Family realized that a lot of these battles for the family in the modern world were going to be won or lost at the state level. So what Focus on the Family did was they formed what are called Family Policy Councils, FPCs. And so that's what Family Institute of Connecticut is. I run the FPC for the state of Connecticut. We're all independent, autonomous, but we're sort of loosely affiliated with Focus on the Family and with one another. Focus on the Family is the mothership. The state councils exist in about 40 of the 50 states.
Yeah.
They are mostly run by Protestants. About six of them are run by Catholics. I'm one of the Catholics. So you've got Connecticut, New Hampshire, and a few other states. And that's what we do. That is the pro-family movement.
I have to say, our non-Christian listeners, I'm going to take a break, and I'll let you answer this when we come back. But there's going to be a lot of people who will say, look, this is the problem with you Christians, is you want to tell everybody else how their family life should go. So are you devastated by that? Are you going to leave, or will you stay and try to answer that when we come back?
I look forward to it.
Okay, we'll be right back with more on the family in the modern world with our guest, Peter Wolfgang, right after this on Catholic Answers Live.
We're here for you. Call now. Catholic Answers Live.
Are you a coffee drinker? If so, you can now enjoy a coffee roasted to perfection by the Carmelite Monks of Wyoming. Delicious Mystic Monk coffee is roasted and prepared by monks in a hidden cloistered monastery and is available in over 25 varieties. All Mystic Monk coffees are works of perfection and labors of love. For more information on how to purchase Mystic Monk coffee, visit mysticmonkcoffee.com. That's mysticmonkcoffee.com.
Now, not only can you watch EWTN anywhere, but anytime with EWTN On Demand. Get on-demand access to more than 12,000 EWTN programs, including live shows and specials, all in one place, all free. Just go to EWTN.com/on-demand. There's nothing to fill out, no memberships required, and no fees to pay. All you need is an internet connection, and you're good to go. EWTN On Demand. Fast, easy, and free.
Welcome back to Catholic Answers Live. We will go to the phone shortly. We're talking about the family in the modern world. Our guest is Peter Wolfgang. Just for a minute, however, sometimes Facebook friends become really good friends, and we have a very good Facebook friend, Donna, in studio with us. And Donna, I think that you and I are on our third year together here in this studio the day before the conference.
We are on our third year. My fourth year, but my third year here.
Coming
with you.
Stopping by. It's wonderful to have you here. Thank you very much for coming.
It's always so much fun to come out here. You guys are wonderful, all of you.
So tell us a little bit about your experience at the conference. Why do you keep coming back? I know why your husband keeps coming back. You drag him.
I drag him.
And you force him.
I don't force him. Okay. He comes willingly, and it's always been so much fun. There's so much knowledge, and you guys are so good. I just can't express how much we learn from you, and so much of it is so it's so emotional. That is what that's what usually gets me, is how good the speakers are.
Yeah.
And how they hit me personally, how they hit everybody personally. And we're just one big, huge, happy family. And
hear you say that. Yeah, because we feel that way here at Catholic Answers, too. And I'm delighted you keep coming back year after year. I know you live at the other end of this great state of California. By the way, are you enjoying being a Catholic in the state of California now that the state of California has decided it hates all Catholics?
I'm not in California. I'm in Nevada.
You're on the other side of the border.
I'm on the other side of the
We should have checked
Tahoe.
Your passport when you came in.
Yeah, I'm in Lake Tahoe.
Yeah.
The other side. Yeah.
Well, Donna, thank you very, very much for coming to the conference. Look forward to seeing you over the course of the next few days. I think it's going to be the best conference ever. More people have signed up than ever. We got more speakers than ever. And the early church was the Catholic Church is a great theme. So thanks for coming, Donna.
Thank you, Cy.
We'll see you over there.
Okay.
All right. Again, we're talking about marriage. We're talking about family. Marriage is part of that. We're talking about family in the modern context. Our guest is Peter Wolfgang. Peter is the president of Family Institute of Connecticut, which advocates on behalf of family. So I left you with a kind of a mean statement, but I do think that this has said a lot about us Christians. Okay, that's fine if that's what you want family to be, but why do you work for the law to define family as, for example, the permanent union of a man and a woman? Why do you work for those things?
Because we care about children. I think that's probably, for a secular audience, for people who don't share our views, I think that's the first thing I would want to say about it. Children do best in a home with their married mother and father. And you know, you don't have to share our Catholic faith to know this. You can look at social science data. Yeah. In fact, this was the amazing thing. You know, I talked about how Dr. Dobson founded Focus on the Family in the 70s, and then in the 80s, organizations, state-level groups like mine were started. Back then, the crisis in the family was mostly divorce and abortion. That was the cutting edge of sort of societal deterioration in the 70s and 80s. And now it's metastasized, right? I mean, divorce and abortion, that's like the good old days. Of course, those things are still with us, but it's gone on to same-sex marriage. It's gone on to gender confusion. It's gone on to drag queens in public libraries teaching three-year-olds how to twerk. You know, when we fought same-sex marriage in the 2000s, we were told, if two people love each other, you know, how does that affect you? That has nothing to do with the rest of society. Well, it turned out to have a lot to do with the rest of society.
Right.
It was a complete restructuring of society, which is precisely the thing that we warned about, in the 2000s. And so coming back to divorce, like, why do you Christians care about this, right? This is, you know, go focus on your own darn family, leave everyone else alone. Well, by the end of the 1990s, well, go back, for instance, to 1992, okay? You may recall the election when Bill Clinton defeated George H.W. Bush. Bush's vice president, Dan Quayle, made this, at the time, famous or infamous speech against a fictional character, Murphy Brown.
Right.
And Murphy Brown was this wealthy anchor woman who was deliberately having a child out of wedlock.
And right.
It was a TV show. But Dan Quayle's point was, we shouldn't glamorize this. You know, Murphy Brown in her fictional world is a wealthy person who can afford to protect her family from the effects of the choices that she's making. But when you teach blue-collar people, working-class people, people who don't have the means, who aren't wealthy jet-setters, that it's okay to have children outside of wedlock, you're hurting them. You're hurting women. You're hurting children. Children do best in a home with both their mom and dad. That was the beginning of the 90s, the early 90s, and he was roundly mocked by everyone.
Right.
And Bush and Quayle lost the election. By the end of the 90s, there were articles on the cover of the Atlantic Monthly saying Dan Quayle was right.
Yeah.
There was all this social science data that said, oh my goodness, this no-fault divorce revolution of the 1970s.
It's hurting people.
It hurt people. Yeah, and it was sold to us as, this is a reform that's going to be more liberating for everyone's going to be happy. The kids won't have to see mom and dad fight. Everyone's going to be better. Kids are resilient. And by the end of the 90s, they had what are called longitudinal social studies that said, no, everyone's worse off. Everyone's more unhappy. And there was actually a consensus among both the left and the right that the divorce revolution had been bad and that we need to rebuild the marriage culture. That broke down in the 2000s for reasons we can get into. I don't know if you wanted to jump to a call, I can go on. Believe me.
No, we'll go to calls. Yeah, I know right. You can. I can tell that, Peter, right away. 888-318-7884 is our number, 888-31-TRUTH. If you have a question about the family in the modern world, if you'd like to challenge our Catholic understanding of the family in the modern world, you are welcome to call. If you'd like to get some help on restoring the family in the modern world, you're also welcome to call 888-318-7884. Joe in Cheshire, Connecticut, watching on YouTube Live. You are first up today. Your question for Peter Wolfgang, please.
Hi, Peter. Hi, Cy. How are you guys?
Hi, Joe.
Hey, Joe.
Peter, I just a quick little bit of background first. So my wife and I welcomed our first baby this spring, and we have a modest home with a modest mortgage and my wife's student loans, and we make a comfortable living by any standard. And we want more than anything to live a life of faith according to the teachings of the church. And we understand that means welcoming as many children into the world as is possible. And, you know, when you start to put pen to paper and you look at the finances and additionally the logistics of raising a family in that way, it starts to seem insurmountable. My question for you is this. I understand that the church offers support, more than support, in the form of the sacraments. But outside of that, does the church have some type of responsibility to couples like us who want to live according to her teachings and overcome the challenges of the modern world?
All right.
The church has a tremendous responsibility to help couples like yours live according to its teachings and overcome the challenges of the modern world. Joe, I love your question. I love that you're from Cheshire, Connecticut. I live two towns over from you. We're both members of the Archdiocese of Hartford. And, I know that there are resources available to help families do that. You know, I actually just flew today from Bradley Airport in Windsor, Connecticut, all the way over here to San Diego. In fact, I got off the airplane all of a half an hour ago and came here straight to the Catholic Answers studio. so if I'm a little out of breath, that's why. But you know, Joe, as I was on the plane coming over here, I was looking at the latest issue of Columbia Magazine, which is the magazine put out by the Knights of Columbus. And in the back pages, they have pages and pages of what the local councils are doing. And I was struck by councils that were, you know, there was this one council that had raised something like $5,000. You know, this was a local council, not supreme, a local council in their own community to help some family that was in dire financial stress. My wife, as we were coming over here, we're Catholic homeschoolers in your area. We know a lot of people in Cheshire and the surrounding area, and we're all on like a prayer network together. And Leslie got an email from someone in our Catholic homeschooling group to pray for this family that was in dire need. You know, there was a crisis in the family, and our community all came together and is all praying for that husband and that family right now. I would say, in answer to your question, absolutely. The church is a community. The church is a family. It's a communion of love. And so it can't just be something that's on paper. It can't just be something that you hear on Catholic Answers, although I hope that you listen to Catholic Answers all the time.
Well done. Did we get a recording of that? Okay, thank you. All right.
But it has to be something that you feel in the flesh and blood, something that's lived in your local parish, in your local Knights of Columbus community council, if you're in your local homeschooling group or your local Catholic school, or if you go to the public school, you should know who the other people at that school are who are members of your parish. And yeah, I mean, I would say too that when we're talking about the church having a responsibility, we can't only mean the bishops and the priests. Don't get me wrong, the bishops and the priests have a grave responsibility to guard the deposit of the faith. Everything that we talked about earlier in this program regarding Humanae Vitae, there's also John Paul II's encyclical on the family in the modern world, apostolic letter, I think it is, or post-apostolic exhortation. If Jimmy was still here, he could tell you. I think it's an exhortation from 1981. Very important documents. Our priests and our bishops should be sharing this with us, the laity, but it's also the role of the laity to take our responsibility as full members of the church to help one another. St. Paul says, bear one another's burdens. That's how we love each other. So I'm very sympathetic to your situation, what you say about, you know, you have a modest home, you want to have another baby, things are tight, you got the wife's student loans that still have to be paid off. My wife and I have 7 children, ages 19 to 3. I don't think I really was gainfully employed until what, Leslie? Like after the fourth child was born. I mean, I'm not necessarily saying you want to do it the way I did it, but sometimes you just want to step out there in faith. I mean, you want to do your responsibilities as a man, as the head of the household, to provide for your family. But you also want to fall on your knees and go before the throne of God, go before the Blessed Sacrament, and put your trust in Him, and it's going to work out.
Joe, thank you very, very much for that call. Appreciate it. Our number here is 888-318-7884, 888-318-7884. We're talking about the family in the modern world, familiaris consortio. That's what you were referring to, the apostolic exhortation
right.
after the synod on the family of Pope John Paul. And if you have questions about the church's understanding of the current predicament of the family in the modern world, if you want to challenge the church's position on the family, you're welcome to call. And if you'd like to engage in that conversation about what can we do, all of us Catholics together, all of us and working with all people of goodwill to restore the proper place of the family in the modern world, as Peter said, for the good of children, give us a call, 888-318-7884. More calls on the family in the modern world right after this.
Catholic Answers Live.
Everybody's favorite Catholic outer space delivery pilots return for their greatest adventure yet in the brand new graphic novel Weapons of War. Fresh from saving the solar system in The Truth Is Out There and saving the timeline of salvation history in The Big Picture, Brendan and Irk land in a magnificent domed city on Mars for what is supposed to be a simple shuttle job. But soon they find themselves caught up in a sinister assault on faith and freedom. Will Mars be lost to the enemy? Brendan and Irk's only hope for the flight is in the power of God's sacramental gifts. A totally new kind of Catholic resource for apologetics and evangelization, the Truth Is Out There series combines the visual excitement and quirky humor of graphic novels with solid popular philosophy and theology. The result is a series in which everyone from teens to adults can find accessible answers to questions about God, the soul, true happiness, and much more. Order your copy of Weapons of War today by calling 844-239-4952, by visiting shop.catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Did you know you can access Catholic Answers Live right from your phone or other mobile device? Download the Catholic Answers Live app today. The Catholic Answers Live app, available now on iOS and Android.
If you're a Catholic who sometimes gets intimidated by the Bible, Jimmy Akin's The Bible is a Catholic Book will help you better understand and take pride in this gift that God gave the world through the church. Don't let anyone tell you otherwise. Catholics are the original Bible Christians. Order your copy of The Bible is a Catholic Book today by calling 844-239-4952, by visiting shop.catholic.com, or asking for it at a good Catholic bookstore near you.
Do you believe you don't measure up?
Tell us why on tomorrow's Take Two with Jerry and Debbie at noon Eastern.
Now let's return to more of Catholic Answers Live.
Welcome back. Catholic Answers Live. We're all getting ready for the conference around here. We'll be joining you from the conference tomorrow. If you're coming to the conference, come by the table, ask a question. It's going to be open forum with Jimmy and Tim tomorrow from the hallway of the conference where folks are registering. It's a lot of fun. And we'd love it if you just come by, ask a question, or just say hello. Today we're talking, this hour we're talking with Peter Wolfgang about the family in the modern world. 888-318-7884 is the number. I think the basic premise here is that the family in the modern world is facing troubled times, and that though the consequences of that are radiating out throughout our society and our culture, and if we want to reverse that trend, we may not have to fix Facebook. We may not have to fix Netflix or whatever the other things are that we might fuss about. But those things might be fixed because people who are raised in whole, healthy, and wholesome families are able to repair the other institutions of the society. Would you agree with that basic premise?
Absolutely.
888-318-7884 is the number, 888-318-7884. Sometimes I ask myself, where is the outrage in some of the things that are done to children now in the name of adults getting to choose whatever they want to choose? And it seems to me that we are now in a position where we are outright buying and selling children with surrogacy, like you will hear about a couple maybe a heterosexual couple, maybe a homosexual couple, but they will go to a foreign country. Mm-hmm. They will use sperm and egg that may be theirs, maybe someone else's, and then they will hire a woman, usually a poor woman. These are not rich women who are volunteering for this because it's cruel. And then they end up basically buying a baby. Mm-hmm. And there's no outrage about this. I spend a good part of my life working with children. I never met a child, no matter how badly abused by a parent, who didn't want to know who their mom and dad are. It's universal. And even when they've been badly abused, they want to see their mom and dad again. This seems to me like such a basic level of cruelty that no one will say anything about because we don't want to offend these families. That's wrong.
Absolutely.
All right, I want to check in with the expert on that.
It's a form of child abuse.
Sure, yeah.
And it's an exploitation of women, usually poor women.
Oh, yes, right.
There's a brilliant, I can't think of her name right now, but you have a brilliant surrogacy activist. An anti-surrogacy activist here in California, a woman who recently converted to Catholicism. Leslie, hold up the name of that. She's fantastic. You should have her on someday. But she really talks about how brutal this is to women, how, you know, you're basically treating women like chattel, you know, yeah, selling their eggs, exploiting them. And it's horrible for children. I mean, this is... We're now hearing of stories of children growing up saying, you know, trying to find their sperm donor father.
Yeah.
And the hole in their life because they don't know.
Yeah. It there's a level of cruelty. It does seem as the sexual revolution becomes the next revolution and then the next revolution and the next revolution, the one constant is that the world gets harder and harder on children.
Yes. And, you know, the scary thing too, Cy, is if you're a certain age... If you can remember, like, the 80s, I mean, there was a time when I was a teenager where there was a certain anxiety in society about this. Like, people knew. It wasn't just a small group that was worked up about it. Society-wide, there was an anxiety about the changes that we were going through culturally and what does this mean for children. Whereas today, in 2019, it's only a small band of, they call us social conservatives, you know, just this one sort of misfit group that doesn't seem to be with the program, and the rest of society, like, that sense of horror has slipped away because we're all so complicit in it now.
Yeah, because right, you might hurt someone's feelings who has done these things. Let us go to where am I going? Let's go to Leanne in Denver, Colorado, listening on the great 1060 AM there in Denver. Leanne, your question for Peter Wolfgang.
Yes, hi. Yes, I'm from Denver, and I'm wondering what advice you would give to families that are being affected by this new law, this new sex ed law that the governor has signed that is, LGBT agenda driven. And we sent our kids to Catholic school, but if we had small children now, I don't know that we could afford to do that. You know, and we worked so hard to pay for the tuition to send them. And now it's, you know, it just gets more and more expensive every year because, you know, you need to pay teachers as decently as you can. So not all Catholic families can afford to send their kids to Catholic school. And the public schools here, you know, we've already started hearing horror stories of teachers, you know, persecuting kids in class that resist this kind of indoctrination.
Right, Leanne. I think that the story that you're telling is a story that is being told all across this country. It certainly is here in the state of California, this idea that teachers have been co-opted or schools have to be co-opted into really pushing an agenda for a certain vision of family. And what do you do as a parent? Because Leanne is correct. Not all parents can afford the other option, you know, oh, well, I'll send them to this school over here. So how do we deal with this?
You know, that was the part of, and Leanne, thank you so much for your question. That was the part of your question, Leanne, that most jumped out at me. I know you're looking for specific advice, but it was the tail end of your comment that really struck me. You know, you put your older kids through Catholic school, but you know, things are getting tight. It's expensive. If you have more children, if you have younger children, and you're not sure you can do it. That's what's going on here. That's sort of what undergirds a lot of the crisis that good, faithful people who know the truth about the family, who want to raise their children with the truth about the family side, what they're up against is they're being deliberately squeezed.
Yeah.
Because if you have the means, if you are wealthy enough, you know, you can put your kids in Catholic school, or maybe you can homeschool your kids, or you can escape the public school system. But that's what it is. It's an escape. What about for all the people that don't have the means to escape?
Yes.
And that's what is so infuriating, because the cultural left, the forces in our society that are pushing this are basically, in a way, making war on the poor. And they're doing this in a number of ways. You know, people need to grow up, particularly if you don't have the means, if you're not affluent, if you're middle class or working class or poor, all the more reason to want to grow up in a home with your married mom and dad. All the stats show that you're more likely to graduate high school, you know, go on to a good job, stay away from drugs, stay away from prison, not get pregnant at an early age and so forth. Like, the one thing you have going for you, if you don't have the financial means, is family stability. And when you take away even that, what you've done in this country is you've stripped the poor of their dignity. And there's a book by a guy named Charles Murray called Breaking Apart, where he talks about the state of America. He focuses specifically on white America, but what's happened since 2010 and how, you know, those working class communities don't have that anymore. I want to name the problem before I back up and address her what can you do question.
Okay.
I do want to address that. Because I think the problem isn't just what's on the surface, it's what's under the surface. This is a war on people who can't afford to get out of the public school system. It's a war on the poor on more than one level. They're going to experiment on your kids. Your kids are their guinea pigs. We ought to recognize this, and we ought to fight against it. Leanne, already that you even recognize that this is a problem is the first step. There's a lot of people, maybe good people, who don't recognize that. Maybe people who work two jobs to take care of their family, are tired, get home at the end of the day, don't really have the time to look into what their kids are being taught in the schools, just trust the public school system, and don't know what's going on. So that you recognize this is already something. The next thing you want to do is, there's strength in numbers. You can't do it on your own. What you want to do is look around for whoever else there is in your area in Colorado who's already fighting this. So I mentioned Focus on the Family is actually headquartered out of Colorado Springs. I know this law was already passed. I know the governor has already signed this law. That's not necessarily the end of the story. Laws can be overturned. Laws can be appealed. If you get a good potential plaintiff, depending on what the fact pattern is, if you can find a potential plaintiff, Alliance Defending Freedom, ADF, which is the legal arm of the pro-family movement, a lot of times they will file lawsuits against laws like this if there's a cause of action.
Yeah.
I don't know if there's a cause of action or not. I don't know the specifics of the law in Colorado. But what you want to do is you want to look up Focus on the Family. You want to look up what the other pro-life organizations, pro-family organizations in Colorado are doing. You want to see if there's a family policy council there. You want to check with the Colorado Catholic Conference. The Catholic Church in every state has what's called the Catholic Conference. That is the official lobbying arm for the Catholic bishops in your state. If there's more than one diocese in your state, the bishops for all those dioceses come together to form a Catholic conference, and the executive director of that Catholic conference is the official lobbyist of the Catholic Church at your state capitol. And that's definitely a group you want to go to. You want to find the Colorado Catholic Conference. You want to talk to them and say, okay, this law has been passed. I don't want my kids raised with this. What's the next step? You're supposed to advocate for lay Catholics. Help me out. What do I do next?
That's a lot. We'll, some of those resources we'll get onto the document. So, I mean, the show notes or, yeah, okay, good. Leanne, it's That is not an easy answer that you just got, but was that a helpful answer?
Well, somewhat, but I actually am pretty plugged in Denver. I try to be involved and pay attention. So I went to some rallies at the Capitol to fight, especially the LGBT law. And I know of all those groups that you just mentioned. And but it just, you know, I work almost full time. You know, my kids are grown. They didn't go to public school. So I just wonder what kind of voice I would have in fighting, you know, this in the public schools. But it just seems like such a Goliath. And I do know of a group, and they actually were, I think, mostly started by a Hispanic foundation to fight that law. And but I haven't heard anything more about them since the law passed. So there may be people in the background right now with a plan to fight it and maybe take the law to court. But I haven't looked into that recently.
Leanne, you have a good heart and you have a good head too. You do sound very plugged in, and you got to remember what happened to Goliath. I mean, it does look, you're right. It looks like fighting Goliath, but it looked bad for King David too. But he had allies that Goliath didn't know about. So we have to take a break. So I'm going to say thank you for the call. I think that very, very many people share your concern and also that sense of how daunting the task is. But the family is worth it. We're talking about the family in the modern world. Our guest is Peter Wolfgang. We'll be right back with more on Catholic Answers Live right after this.
This is Archbishop Paul Coakley, the Archdiocese of Oklahoma City, and you're listening to Catholic Answers Live.
The leading Catholic voices are on EWTN Radio.
Our mission is to transform the world one woman at a time through a spiritual program of formation that helps them to see who they are as daughters of the Most High God and to enjoy the gift that God has given to them by virtue of their femininity.
Women of Grace with Jeanette Bankovic Williams. Tomorrow morning, 11 Eastern, on EWTN Radio.
We have a big problem. Our culture is dying, and souls are in danger of being lost. The answer is conversion to Jesus Christ in His church. St. Paul Street Evangelization is a Catholic organization, and we have hundreds of teams spreading the good news throughout the country. But we need your help. The harvest is great, but the laborers are few. Find out more and get involved today at streetevangelization.com. That's streetevangelization.com.
Family of the Modern World, this hour on Catholic Answers Live. I am Cy Kellett, your host. Our guest is the very low energy Peter Wolfgang from Hartford, Connecticut. Happy to have him with us. Let's go to Frank. I'm going to try to get to as many calls as I can. Frank in Portland, Oregon, listening on 88.3 FM. Your question, please, Frank.
Hey, thanks for taking my call, guys. I'm calling because regarding that earlier caller, the guy who's from the same hometown area, it seemed like he had said in his question that he believes that the Catholic Church teaches that married couples are supposed to have as many children as possible biologically.
Yeah.
And my understanding is that that is not actually the Church's teaching, and that, you know, you can prudently use natural family planning for, you know, for good reason.
Yep. Okay.
Including, you know, financial aspects. I'm just curious to get some input on that.
Okay, Frank, you are 100% correct. And Pope Francis has been quite clear about this. But I'm going to be honest with you, Frank. A lot of people won't accept what Pope Francis says. So I'll read you from a document, 1983, from Pope John Paul II. It's called the Charter on the Rights of the Family. It's one of the great documents on the family you will ever read. I hope every Catholic will read it. The Charter on the Rights of the Family. It says this. The spouses have the inalienable is a really hard word. The spouses have the inalienable right to found a family and to decide on the spacing of births and the number of children to be born. Inalienable means no one can take that right away from you. Taking into full consideration their duties towards themselves, their children already born, the family and society in a just hierarchy of values and in accordance with the objectives of moral order, which excludes the recourse to contraception, sterilization, and abortion. It cannot be clearer. It is up to the parents to decide on the spacing and number of children. And there are lots of people who will argue over what each word of that statement means, but I think you can get the clear meaning from it. Is that true, Frank?
Yes, absolutely. You know, I had not heard that particular reference, and that is
most people haven't.
Clear, so.
Yep. All right.
Yeah,
thanks.
Thank you.
Thanks, Frank. Did you want to add anything to that?
No, I cannot improve on John Paul the Great. I'm sitting across from you because of him.
It's hard. You're right. It's hard to improve on John Paul the Great. Yeah. Although, I have to say that is the consistent teaching of the church for many generations. So he just has a way of phrasing it. By the way, the Charter on the Rights of the Family comes from the same church synod that Familiaris Consortio, which we mentioned earlier, comes from. There are two documents that are produced following the same synod. So I suggest all parents read both of them. Because the church has a teaching on the family in the modern world, and you'll find it in those two documents. Again, 888-318-7884 is the number, 888-318-7884. Anonymous caller next. I'm sorry you have waited a while, Anonymous. I apologize for that. Your question for Peter Wolfgang.
Oh, thank you so much for taking the call. So my family's being pulled apart severely, first by a horrible divorce, due to alcoholism that my ex-husband left, well, my husband at the time left the marriage years ago. So I was left raising a two-year-old and a six-month-old, raised the kids now to adulthood, and my daughter is in the process of transgendering. So it is tearing our family apart once again. And I went to a priest. She was trying to come back into the Catholic Church, and then a week ago said, I can't walk in there. I just don't belong. So she said, I need you to come to my church, and I didn't know what that church was. So I said, I'm sorry, but I have to stick with God. So I made that decision. So just two-part, I feel like, I need to stick with God. If I go her path and support her, I feel like I'm just walking into a bad, like Satan world that I can't go into. So I have to let her know that I love her, but I can't walk her path. And so then I went to my church and I asked my pastor if he could, I needed a strong spiritual director to talk to her. And he basically said he wasn't qualified. And I said, who is qualified here? You know, I desperately need somebody to talk to her to just change her path, and I didn't get any answer. So I don't know if there's anything. I know, Peter, you're involved in Connecticut. I didn't know about this family counseling council policy, but I'm in Massachusetts. I'd love to get involved with it, but I didn't know if you had any direction you can point me in.
Okay, Anonymous. Thank you very much. I'm very sorry to hear, especially about the abandonment by your husband. It's not an uncommon story. You have our prayers, but Peter?
Yes, I do have some directions I'd like to point you in. Let me say, first of all, that I'm going to be praying for you. And I know this is a situation that families in previous generations, families probably as recently as 5 years ago, didn't have to deal with. But this is something that has rapidly overtaken us. So, resources. You say you're in Massachusetts. I want to recommend to you, first and foremost, the Massachusetts Family Institute. That is our sister organization in Massachusetts. It's run by a very good friend of mine named Andrew Beckwith. And he's a good guy. He can point you to resources locally in Massachusetts. There's something else I want you to be aware of. Excuse me. Courage International. They're headquartered out of Trumbull, Connecticut. Now, Courage is a Catholic apostolate that works specifically with same-sex attraction. And they have a group called Courage, you know, for people who are same-sex attracted. They have a group called Encourage for the family members of people who are same-sex attracted, who are living the gay lifestyle and so forth. I understand your situation is a little different. It's a little newer. You know, we now hear the phrase LGBT, and they're always adding new letters, but T is the most recent of those four letters. And we're all still sort of getting a handle on what this is, how best to deal with it. I think you're doing the correct thing in drawing boundaries and saying, look, there's certain places I can't go. You're right to go to your priest. It's unfortunate that your priest didn't say, look, it's beyond my expertise, but hold tight. I'm going to do some research and get back to you with someone who can help you. My guess is if you call Courage International, if you speak to Father Bochansky, who's the head of it, or his staff, they will get you someone. They will be able to point you to therapists that can help you with this and give you the best advice on what to do and not do regarding your daughter. It's a very careful path, and I think they can walk you through it.
Okay, Anonymous.
Okay. I'll just tell you one little divine intervention that I could share with everybody. There's a little local gift shop just about 10 miles from me, and the owner of it was just, I think he's an angel that just came to me because he pointed me to a novena by Jesus to Father Dolindo Ritolo. I had never heard of that priest before, but Jesus came to him back in the 1800s, and it's a surrender novena. So I'm on day five of that. So
oh, praise God for that.
I'm just hoping and praying. It's a novena that I need to surrender this whole thing to Jesus.
Amen.
And just pray.
Amen.
For
I have to say, Anonymous, you had mentioned earlier about not letting go of God because I think you were right on. I think you would agree, Peter. She is correct. Stay with the,
absolutely
whatever the priest may say. Stay going to Mass. Stay in contact with the sacraments.
Hug the sacraments tight, particularly the Eucharist.
Because God loves you, and because the world is insane doesn't mean that we have to go down that path. Even when we want so much to love our children and walk any path we have to walk to help them through what they're going through. Anonymous, thank you very much. I'm going to try to get one more question in from Anonymous in Midland, Texas, listening on John Paul II Catholic Radio. Anonymous in Midland, Texas, can you be kind, I'm sorry to do this, but can you be kind of quick with your question?
Yes, so I've just based off of your previous couple of callers that touched on the school deal and finances. One, why is it so expensive? I mean, you want a lot of kids, you want to send them to the Catholic school, you want them to be raised in the church and have all of that support to teach them as much as they can. Why is it so expensive? And two, you know, we tithe a certain percent, we offer a certain percent of what we make. Will the church ever consider or anything of having brackets, basically? Because
you can actually, I'm going to speak to this real quick, Anonymous, because there are dioceses around the country who are working very hard on this. I don't know what's happening there in Midland, Texas, but I know you have a very strong bishop there. Did you want to say anything about the cost of Catholic school?
Yeah, look, this is speculation on my part. Take it for what it is. But I think in the next several years, you're going to see a new model of Catholic school. That's going to be very different than what we've traditionally had in the United States. There are these classical Catholic homeschooling hybrid programs.
Like Regina Caeli. Right.
Where our kids went to school.
Oh, I had no idea you were connected with Regina Caeli. I'm very fond of them at Regina Caeli. So look at that little bit of
and it's more cost effective.
Yeah, that's right. And also pray for women religious. They're the ones who it was their sacrifice that made Catholic education in the United States possible. And they were, they were great, wonderful women. They get a bad rap a lot, but pray for women religious because whatever else might happen. They were the ones that gave it to us before, and if more women will follow the call to be educators for the good of families, we'll all be better off. Peter Wolfgang, I really enjoyed this conversation. I hope you'll do it again with us sometime.
Likewise, Cy. Thank you.
I ask you on the air because then you can't say no. All right. We'll see you at the conference tomorrow.
Absolutely.
And your wife, Leslie, right, is here with us. We'll see you at the conference tomorrow. Donna, Bob, we'll see you. Thanks. Did I get that right? Bob, did I say... Was Bob wrong? It is? I apologize, Bob. Was nobody going to tell me the right name? What? All right, we'll see you at the conference. We'll see you all from the conference tomorrow. I think I pronounced every name right today. See you then. God willing, on Catholic Answers Live.